Today, this day of Eid al-Adha, in Urdu we say Bari Eid. Here in Turkey we say Kurban Bayrama. On this day we commemorate. This is the day when the Prophet Abraham submitted to God's command to slaughter his son. The word in the Quran is not sacrifice, it's slaughter. Sacrifice comes from the biblical versions of this story. The word in the Quran is, the Prophet Abraham said, "Inni ara fil manami anni azbahuk." The word is slaughter. Atheists get upset when they hear this story. They express moral outrage and they say that this story shows that God is cruel and bloodthirsty and that people who obey him and follow his commands also become cruel and bloodthirsty. Now, that might be true of a number of ancient pagan religions where people used to sacrifice human beings, children often, as part of their rituals. To an extent, it might be true of Christianity, where God sent his only son, who according to Christian belief was human as well as divine, to be sacrificed, to be not just slaughtered but crucified. But it's not true of Islam, it's not true of the religion that God, the creator of the universe, revealed to any of his prophets since the beginning of the history of mankind, and that's what I'm going to explain to you in this video. Every single messenger that God sent since the beginning of the history of mankind came to put an end to the shedding of blood. There is no sin, there is no act of disobedience greater in the sight of God, apart from disbelieving in him, than the shedding of human blood. The preservation of life is one of the five universal objectives of every sacred law that has never been abrogated. Killing human beings, especially killing children, is a crime. Everybody should express moral outrage at it. In the Quran, the one who slaughters children is Pharaoh. He, in the Quran, the word is ذَبَح, يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. He used to slaughter the sons of the children of Israel. We all know the story of Moses. May God bless him and give him peace. And the pagan Arabians to whom the Prophet was sent, they used to kill their daughters because they preferred sons over daughters. And the Quran denounces this in the strongest of terms, and there's a moral outrage. God says in the Quran, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. On the day of judgment, that girl who was killed by her cruel father, hard-hearted father, will be brought back to life and will be asked, why were you killed? So that the father can be brought to justice and be given the punishment that he deserves. So what do we make of the story when God commanded the Prophet Abraham to slaughter his son? I'm going to tell you five things which, if you understand, will remove all of the doubts that you could have about this story. The first comes from a rule of legal theory, the science of usul al-fiqh, that Muslims have been teaching for 1,000 years, and it comes out of this story. And that rule is, they say, يَجُوزُ نَسْخُ الْفِعْلِ قَبْلَ التَّمَكُّنِ, which means that it's possible for the command to do an action to be abrogated before someone is able to do it. So what happened here was that the Prophet Abraham was commanded to slaughter his son, and he complied, but before he was able to slaughter his son, God abrogated the ruling, and he said, don't slaughter him. So this was known by God since the beginning. God knew that he would not slaughter his son. And God knew that he would, in fact, never be able to realize this command. So this is the first thing I want you to keep in mind. God never intended for the son to be slaughtered. I'm going to come back to this rule in a future point. Point number two. Why was he commanded then? What's the point of the command? The point of the command is for the Prophet Abraham and his son to express their love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you love someone, you express your love by choosing them, by preferring them over yourself. You really want something, but you prefer what the other person, what the beloved wants over your own preferences. If the beloved wants something and you say, no, I want this, I'm not going to give you what you're asking for, then this means you don't really love them. So what's happening here is that the Prophet Abraham and his son, I'm going to talk about his son in a second, they are choosing God. They are choosing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over themselves, not out of a fear that they are immediately going to be burned to cinders, but out of a genuine love and recognition of His goodness and His favors upon them, and complete trust in Him that even if we don't understand what's beneficial in this for us, we believe completely that the good and kind and merciful Lord who we know is only commanding us to do this because there is some good in it, and He has lavished His favors upon us, and we love Him, and so we want to choose Him over ourselves. This is the consummate expression of love, because there is nothing greater that could be chosen over. Point number three. When I said in the beginning, this is the day when we commemorate that the Prophet Abraham chose to submit to his Lord's command to slaughter his son, I omitted something there. I omitted mention of his son. His son also submitted. God didn't command him to run after him with an axe, and the son is running away, and he's saying, come here, my son, I must kill you, even if you're running away from me, and you don't know what's good for you. No, that's not what God commanded him to do. God commanded him to go to his son. So in the Quranic version of the story, he goes to his son and he tells him, "Inni ara fil manami anni azbahuk." He tells him that I saw in a dream that I am slaughtering you. And it means it's a command from God. And he refers to his son as my little son, Ya Bunayya. And what does his son say? His son says, Ya Abati, oh my dear beloved father, if'al ma tu'mar, do whatever you have been commanded. Satajiduni insha'allahu min as-sabirin. You will find me, God willing, to be of those who are patient. So the father is concerned about his son. The son is concerned about his father. That's point number four. I'm going to put them both together here. So let me go to point number four. I'll come back to point number three. Point number four is that they both love each other. They're both full of love and mercy. And the way that the command was complied with, the commentators explain, is that they go out of their way to comfort the other, to console the other, to prevent the other from feeling the pain. The father is blindfolded. The son is turned so that he doesn't see where the knife is coming from. They love each other and they are cooperating. They are cooperating in their submission to the God that they love even more, that they trust in even more. And so point number three is that the son willingly submitted as well out of love for God, not because he was going to be burned to cinders if he disobeyed. And the fourth point is that the entire story is full of love and mercy. There's no cruelty. There's no bloodthirstiness anywhere. Point number five, the last point, the most important point, is that both the Prophet Abraham and the Prophet Ismail, his son, they both did this out of trusting in God's kindness, in His love, out of gratitude. They trusted in God because they knew that He would not command them to do anything except that in which there was the greatest benefit imaginable in it for them, even if they didn't understand. Where does this trust come from? This trust, the Prophet Abraham, God bless him and give him peace, he mentioned in another verse, he talked about the God, the Lord who he worshipped. He said, الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ وَالَّذِي هُوَ يُطْعِمُنِي وَيَسْقِينَ وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ وَالَّذِي يُمِيتُنِي ثُمَّ يُحْيِينَ وَالَّذِي أَطْمَعُ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ لِي خَطِيئَةِ يَوْمَ الدِّينَ. He said, he described his Lord, he said, he is the one who created me from nothing. I wouldn't exist if he did not create me. فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ. He is the one who guides me. Guides me to what? Guides me to everything that is beneficial for me in this life and the next. He is the one who gives me food to eat. Every time I eat, it's God who's creating everything. The Prophet Abraham saw the entire world as contingent. He saw that every single thing that he is doing, every single thing that he experiences is coming from God. When he eats, it's God that's feeding him. It's God that's nourishing him. When he drinks, it's God that's giving him to drink. It's God that's nourishing him. When he lives, when he dies, it's all God and who's doing all of these things. When he gets sick, it's God who cures him. And so he sees the goodness and generosity of God everywhere. He's drowning in the blessings of God. And he has complete trust and certainty in the generosity of God. He's trusting in God. His son is trusting in God too. And this is why they're doing what they're doing. And this is the lesson that this story has for us. This is why we commemorate his choice, their choice on this day. I want you to see that this choice that both of them made, this act of trust, this act of love, which increased them in their closeness to God, in their love of God, could not have been realized except in this way, except by commanding them to do something that was so difficult, and except in their choosing to do it, and then the generosity of God manifesting itself in the abrogation of that command. This is the only way in which this could have been done. This is the only way in which these things could have been realized. And the only one in the history of mankind who was commanded, who will ever be commanded to do this, to go through this, is the Prophet Abraham. This is a special command for people who are extremely close to God, who have a knowledge and trust and love of God that no other human being has, the prophets and messengers, the best of mankind. And it's not something, alhamdulillah, you know, I'm grateful. I know that God will not trust someone like me who's weak and unable to even comply with the everyday commands that he does, that he commands me. And we can rest assured that this is not something that we will ever be commanded to do. It's beyond our capacity. And God does not burden a soul with anything greater than it can bear. But what we see in here is we see a model. We see a model of love of God, submission out of love to God, trust in God. So when the next time it comes to pay our zakat and we have to take money and we have to give it to the poor and choose them over ourselves, and we find some kind of a difficulty in it, we remember this example. We remember the sublime example of the Prophet Abraham, and this inspires us to trust in God, to do what he's commanded, and to believe that when we do this, there will be some great good that will come out of it in this life and the next. When the next time comes to pray, when it comes to fast next Ramadan, to do any of the obligations that we need to do, to avoid any of the sins that we need, that we are commanded to avoid, and we are faced with this difficulty, then this example will inspire us. That's why we commemorate this story on this day. Happy Eid to all of you. Eid Mubarak.